I'd like to call the August 16, 2010, Public Health, Safety, and Judiciary Committee to order, please. Would the minute taker please take roll call?
Here.
Alderman Roy Wesley.
Here.
Alderman Coles. Alderman Police. Alderman Cadella.
Here.
Alderman Eugene Wesley.
Here.
Alderman Winger.
Here.
Alderman Shockey.
Here. I thank you that we have a quorum. First item is approval of minutes of May 27th, 2010.
So move.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. We have a Mr. John O'Halloran here today, I take it, to speak to us. Why don't you please take a seat? And there's a microphone on the desk.
I'm actually going to work off that projector, so.
We'll take the mic with.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, sir, and thanks for inviting me, and thanks for moving me up in the agenda. Appreciate that. As indicated, my name is John O'Halloran. I'm an external affairs manager for ComEd. Work with a number of municipalities in DuPage County, including Wooddale. And after the storms of June, contacted by Wally and arranged to come in. I've got a presentation, kind of high level on the storm, high level on the storm response efforts that we follow, and then some information about Wooddale, and then just open it up for questions and comments. I'm sure many of you were in the area on Friday, June 18th, when this particular, the first of the storms in that week hit. It was a very impressive wall cloud. I was on the road that at the time that it hit, and knew when it was coming that it was going to be a bad storm with numerous interruptions throughout the entire service territory. It's just kind of a recap of the 18th through the 27th. Multiple storm fronts struck our service territory over the really the 10 days from Friday the 18th to June 28th, resulting in about 1 million customer interruptions. Our service territory covers the northern third of Illinois, from basically the Mississippi River across to Lake Michigan, from the Wisconsin line down to about I-80. And like indicated, during that time, throughout that service territory, we were charged with restoring about a million customers over that period. 120,000 lightning strokes recorded in the service territory. Lightning obviously hits the highest things above ground. A lot of times that's our transmission towers or our poles, and lightning itself can cause outages. And then wind speeds of 70 to 80 miles an hour throughout the service territory. The 18th and the 23rd, those storms in particular, packed some pretty significant winds, and obviously tree contact, broken poles, wires down as a result of those winds caused many of the outages. The bottom is 1 hour increments from 6:18 through the 28th, indicating the number of customers on the system out of service. And obviously peaking June 18th storm, a little bit of a storm on the 22nd, and then that Wednesday afternoon storm on June 23rd, and then another one on that following on the 26th. A little more detail on the Friday storm. Hit about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, numerous lightning strikes, and that storm itself knocked out about 530,000 customers. We had been obviously anticipating the arrival of that storm. So we had all of our storm centers open. We had our storm response teams already manning the offices. We had the crews on hold. We had the contractors, ready to join us to work to restore power. Rockford heavily hit. Des Plaines was heavily hit. City of Chicago was heavily hit. There was a transmission line down along Mannheim Road over in Des Plaines that, knocked out. That transmission corridor itself serves hundreds of thousands of customers. So when those kinds of events occur, we have to get that transmission system put back together. Following that storm on Monday, we had another small storm, lesser winds, but still about 77,000 customers affected, again, throughout the service territory. Wednesday afternoon, about 4 o'clock, again, the same type of thing, severe damaging winds and a lot of lightning strokes again. This time knocked out about 340,000 customers. Unfortunately, many of the customers affected by that Wednesday storm had just been restored from the Friday storm. We'd been working Friday, Saturday, Sunday into Monday, restoring customers. Tuesday, we kind of catch our breath, and then Wednesday afternoon, the 23rd, we get another storm. Our goal, obviously, get people up as quickly as possible, and that storm on the 23rd, about 90% of the customers were restored within 20 hours of losing power. Saturday morning, the 26th, another small storm, and then again on Sunday, the 27th. So that period was a very active period in terms of weather, wind, lightning, and rain. In Wooddale, we recorded about 20 outages over that period, impacting over 3,100 customers. When we say outages, if my lights went off at home tonight and I called in and I was the only customer, that would be an outage. That would be assigned an outage number. It would be worked and recorded and closed out. When a transformer in someone's backyard fails, it might serve 6 customers. 4 out of 5 of those customers call in. Those 4 calls are grouped into one ticket, and that ticket is worked and restored and closed out. So that would become one outage. On a stormy day, well, let's say a car hit a pole and took out 500 customers. Those 500, not all those 500 customers would have to call. We would realize that there's a problem affecting 500 customers, and we would call that outage, that we would call that incident one outage. So when we say 20 outages impacted 3,000 customers, some of those outages might have been 1 or 2 customers. Some of them were 1,000 customers. But in total, we acted upon 20 outage tickets impacting over 3,000 customers in Wooddale. And again, causes of the outages, as I said, the high winds, broken tree limbs or branches. We saw some uprooted trees through those storms, and then the lightning damage. Downed wires, blown fuses, mostly caused by the lightning strikes. Just put such a charge into the lines that it just blows the fuse there to protect it. We're constantly reviewing the reliability of all of our circuits, all the lines that serve all of our customers, and we're always looking for those circuits that need improvement. We have a regular reliability meetings with our reliability group, and at those meetings we go circuit by circuit, which ones meet the criteria for underground cable work, mid-circuit recloser program, tree trimming. Those types of things are the most common reliability work that we perform. Underground cables, all the equipment has a lifespan. Underground cables, 30, 35, 40 years, depending on the soil conditions, depending on what was built over the lines, whatever. We've got a couple of different projects that we do with cables. Diagnostic testing, this is a high voltage test that we do to the cable to see how it reacts to a test. We take it out of service, we isolate it, and then we attach a device to test it to see, based on specifications, how it's performing. If it passes the test, we put it back in service. If it fails the test, we take it out of service and replace it. Treatment of cables, we've got a new process that we're using, an injection of a proprietary polymer where we go into a pad-mounted transformer, we disconnect the cable, we hook a device onto it, and we force this polymer in to seal any micro cracks that might appear in the cable. Underground cable, it expands, it contracts, over time with the amount of load going through it. And what happens is the insulating jacket on the outside can crack, and then it just fails. It just spontaneously shorts out. So the contractor we work with on the treatment process has assured us that injecting this polymer into a cable that can be injected will extend the life of the cable. And then the third thing we do with cable is when it's had numerous faults, numerous failures, we'll just outright replace it. We do a great deal of that on a scheduled basis where we sit down with our reliability engineers and we say, okay, what sections of cable have had numerous faults, and let's go out there this year, this summer, this fall, whatever, and replace those sections. Other sections of cable, if we have a sudden spate of cable faults for whatever reason, then that's ordered up for replacement on an emergency basis. And in that case, we'll have one of our contractors install new cable there. Mid-circuit closers, that's another program that we've been involved in the last couple of years. On the primary system, the distribution system that you see along the roadways, the circuits are all networked out in the field. Right now, the majority of those connections between the circuits have to be switched manually. So if there's a problem on circuit A, we know we can go to a certain location, open a switch, close a switch, and pick up circuit A off of circuit B. Right now, much of that switching has to be done manually. These mid-circuit reclosers are automated devices up on the pole that senses the problem on the line and then automatically opens or closes whatever they're programmed to do to reduce the outage impact. So this is a program we've been doing it a couple of years now. We're installing more and more all the time. The intention there is to limit the extent of the outage. So if heater A serves 1,000 people and it goes out of service for some reason, and it's equipped with this automation, then for example, a switch in the middle of the line opens up and only 500 customers are out of service. 500 people are restored off another feeder. So that's the idea of the mid-circuit recloser program, is to try to use automation to reduce the outage impact. Tree trimming, we do tree trimming regularly on a two-year cycle. We do the main section of the feeder, the three lines, the trees adjacent to the three lines up on the pole, and then in four-year cycles, we do the entire feeder, so the three-line portion, and then the single-line portion that goes into the backyards and neighborhoods. What we're doing with the tree trimming is identifying those trees that pose a danger of growing into the lines, falling onto the lines. We're not trimming for 60, 70, 80 mile an hour winds. Those winds of that speed are still gonna blow and break and cause tree contact, but we're trying to prevent the trees that, the quick growing trees from growing up into the lines and causing momentary interruptions or full scale interruptions. But tree trimming, we do it on, like I said, a year-round basis all through the service territory. Okay. Kind of switch over to the storm response mode. Like I said before, we're constantly watching the Weather Channel. We've got weather services. Our business is driven by weather in terms of kilowatt hour sales on hot summer days, and then storm response on stormy summer winter days. So we're constantly monitoring the weather. The weather forecasters are giving us scenarios of what may happen, what's likely to happen. We get alerts, we get warnings, and then our emergency operations center in Joliet structures itself accordingly. If there's a severe enough storm predicted to approach, we'll open up the command center down in Joliet. It's a dedicated room manned by management people that are the are the hub of the storm response operation. And then each of the regions, Chicago, West, South, and North, each have their storm team, which goes into that region's storm hub office. And that's the office team that manages the storm, manages the restoration process out in the field. Contract crew war room, if an event is big enough, we'll call in our contractors, professionals that work for us and with us every day. If we feel that we're going to need their assistance, we'll pull them in. And we also pull in crews from other utilities throughout the Midwest if it's a bad enough storm. So we scale up that way. And then if necessary, we've got some extras on here. If it's bad enough, we'll have local crew staging areas in local offices. We had a transmission, like I said, we had the transmission incident over in Des Plaines. We set up a remote incident command center just to work on that transmission outage. So we've got this system in place all the time. We drill it, we open it up as necessary, and just work down the outage tickets throughout the storm. External affairs and then regulatory affairs are EA/LCX command center. That's our account management group that works with the large commercial industrial customers to assist getting them restored to power. So that would be a hospital, a school, a large manufacturer who's got hundreds or thousands of employees, and those customers have dedicated account managers that work throughout the year, not just on storm activities, but throughout the year with those customers. Like I said, throughout those storms, we had over 450 crews out in the field. We brought in contractor crews from around the Midwest. The way the field crews work is they work a 16-hour shift and then 8 hours off. So we've got them on staggered shifts. So when the storm is coming, we'll send a group home. So they're ready at midnight, for example. And then the day shift will continue working till their 16 hours are up. We'll bring a shift in. We rotate through the period. And they'll work as many days in that fashion until the storm's cleaned up. And in these last couple cases, I mean, there were eight or more days where these crews were on 16 hours on, 8 hours off. And then the 2,500 field and office people, that's people like myself, that's engineers that are behind the scenes working, putting together the job packets, ordering the equipment, making sure the material's available. So when the truck pulls up, they've got the pole, they've got the wire, they've got the widgets to replace what was broken and put the customers back in service. Tree trimming crews, we've got numerous contractors that work with us. And again, they're usually the first ones to go out to clear the down trees, uprooted trees off the line, so then our crews can pull out the old stuff and set the new ones. And again, the tree trimming crews are dispatched part of that overall storm response on a regional basis. This is just kind of a high level of the overall storm restoration process. The step one, the high voltage transmission lines, usually on the metal towers, those are the first things that we have to get back in service. They usually aren't affected by thunderstorms. They're more vulnerable to tornadoes or ice, that type of thing. But where there is a problem, when there is a problem on the transmission line, those can literally affect hundreds of thousands of customers in like the entire region, not just in the ComEd service territory, because those transmission lines are all networked throughout the nation, basically. So occasionally we'll have an issue on a transmission line. We lost one a couple of years ago to a tornado down off of 57. We had some damage earlier in June out by Dwight, and there was a tornado that went through. So, you know, we had to work around these broken towers and then restore them to service. The second step is where most of our energy goes, is toward the damage to the distribution system. That's the wood poles and the wires that we have virtually everywhere. Each circuit comes out of a substation. We've got numerous substations around the area, and each of those circuits, let's say, serve 1,000 customers. It can be a mix of residential customers, commercial industrial customers, life safety accounts, whatever, but most of the feeders serve a variety of customers. So when we have a big storm go through, we've got, for instance, let's say 200 of those feeders totally out of service. So if each of those serves 1,000 customers, say there's 200,000 customers out on just feeders that are out of service due to the storm. We call that a lockout, where the whole feeder from the substation breaker out to the last customer is out of service. So we categorize those locked out feeders in terms of which ones provide power to those critical facilities: hospitals, police, fire, water reclamation, water pumping, communication systems. We've got a database of that information. We work with the municipalities, the counties, whoever, and we say, okay, you know, what facilities are out of power that, you know, provide these critical services. So the first blitz is to restore service to as many of those feeders as quickly as possible. So we have regular update calls throughout the storm process, and the command center down in Joliet is in contact with the regional offices, and they're holding those managers accountable for feeder XYZ serves the Lake Forest Hospital. Feeder ABC serves the 911 center for DuPage County, DuCom. So those feeders are, you know, the available crews are assigned to those feeders to get that main stem of that feeder back in service, close that breaker back in so more repairs can be done downstream. So the first, usually 18, 24, 36 hours of a big storm, we're focusing on the main gut of the feeder, the main stem of the feeder, which serves the majority of these critical facilities. While that's going on, other people are looking at the damage that's occurred downstream. So the line that goes down Irving Park Road, There's repairs being made on that. There's an assessment and repairs being made on that. And then into the neighborhoods, we're looking to say, okay, behind this house, there's a broken pole, and here's some downed wire, and here's a blown transformer. That information's going back up to the regional center, and then that equipment is being ordered and sent to those locations. So when the main stem of the feeder is restored, these larger outages downstream can be fixed. There's no sense in going to step three until we've got those main sections of the feeders restored. So we're trying to get the main stem, the critical facilities, and then the large groups of customers on those downstream lines. Step four is the neighborhoods, individual services. This is where there's a single phase line goes through my backyard, and a tree's fallen on that. We've patrolled it, we've walked it down, we've identified what the problem is, and as the crews work through the larger outages, contractor crews or our crews will get into those backyards and make those repairs to those blown transformers, those downed wires. The tough ones are the individual services, where the line from the pole to the house has come down, pulled the riser pipe away from the house. Customers responsible for that riser pipe, they have to make the repair. That's where you get into the long, unfortunately, extended outages. And the last check mark is probably the most important one. We have to do this all, you know, with the safety of our employees and the customers top priority. Obviously, electricity doesn't give you any second chances. We have to make sure that the equipment's dead, de-energized, grounded before we work on it. And a lot of times, you know, we'll be waiting for that confirmation from people downstream before we can close in a fuse, because we don't want someone up on a pole trying to do a repair and the line gets relivened. So, the safety is always the biggest priority. Storm damage, I can't see the picture too well, but it's a transmission line over Des Plaines. I mean, these poles were broken, laying down, the wires were holding them up. Not a good situation in terms of electric system. Over 500 downed or displaced poles, 113 transformers, 75 miles of cable, and then those transmission structures damaged. All this stuff has to be ordered, gotten to the location, installed, and part of the restoration. Municipal outreach, we've got 400 municipalities. We've got a system in place. We started a couple of years ago to provide outreach to those municipalities, high-level stuff, saying that, you know, we're aware of a storm coming. We've mobilized our teams. And then people like myself and the command centers work to identify the critical customer restoration. Like I said, that's an important first step. We've got electronic messages that go out to municipalities, to the press. We're in contact with the Illinois Commerce Commission, the Illinois Emergency Management Agency, if the storm is severe enough. And then the call center, obviously, their business goes through the roof as well. During that period in June, they got over 700,000 calls, most of them through the automated service, and we're receiving 14,000 calls in a half-hour period. Again, those employees work the same 16-hour shifts, and then we've got the ability to pull in some other employees from our other operations departments, Billings, and our sister utility, PECO. So we're trying to, trying to manage that increase in call volume. And just a couple more pictures of broken stuff. Everyone, you lose a transmission line, you're obviously facing some challenges there. Open up for questions.
I got a question.
Wait, please. Thank you for a pretty comprehensive review of storms. But what's interesting is in the facts
you gave us, you're talking about storm-related about 1/6 of the time that we have outages. We have some circuits. We have, 19 circuits in Wooddale, supposedly. In 2009, we have 10 outages in one circuit alone. Circuit 110, whatever that is. There's another one, 105, that has 5 outages in just that short period, just 1 year. Out of the 63 outages that you show for Wooddale, over half are related to equipment failure, not storms. The only storm-related ones you had were 3 for lightning and 5 for weather-related, as far as I can find. So it's interesting about the storms, but we expect that from storms. We don't expect it on a routine basis almost 10 times a year from an underground failure or equipment failure. If I might say, it was about 8 years ago, if I'm correct, 8 or 9 years ago, we had somebody from ComEd, I'm not sure who it was at the time, come in and talk to us because of the frequency of the outages in Wooddale. The manager asked him to come in. He talked to us and listened to us. After that, for about 5 years, it was fine. I mean, there were very few outages. It seemed like ComEd was staying on top of things. But now for the last 4 years or so, it seems to have exploded again. For just Wooddale to have a total of 63 outages in a 12-month period, that's 5 outages a month, more than one a week, or 52 weeks. So it's more than one a week outage, and the majority of it is equipment failure. That's what we're concerned about. It's the circuits or the areas that you show us here that are continually going out, even when there's no storm. I don't know if you can explain that or if you can comment on that. Am I reading it incorrectly? You show that their overhead equipment related was 582 times in that 1 year. Tree related was 930, but underground equipment related, 410 customer interruptions. That seems like, it just seems like an exorbitant, a total of 2,794 customer outage interruptions. And some of these were what, 1,741 minutes? I know we had an outage that was over 3 days. And I know I'm not even talking about this year, which it's expanded again. But there's outages here you show of 2,609 minutes, 2,950 more, 4 minutes, 1,818 minutes. And most of those are not storm related, or that I can see of any of these long ones, they're just equipment related. What I'm saying is that ComEd seemed to be working on the job for a while there after we complained a number of years ago. But now it seems like Wooddale is just kind of pushed on the side, and we're having so many equipment-related failures that it's out of sorts now. It just isn't correct.
And I believe you've got this page in the report also with the bar graphs, the upper left-hand bar graph. That's the system average interruption frequency index.
Excuse me, what page are you? SAIFI, non-storm.
It's the page with the four graphs. Third.
Wooddale reliability performance year and report, yeah. You're talking about?
That's what he's talking about.
Okay.
And the bar, the upper left-hand graph is, or chart, is the average interruption frequency. So for the entire municipality, we look at the customers, what's the